Yeah, hello and welcome to our next webinar with the topic ABB Secure at Home. My name is Thorsten Reibel. Yeah, today is the speaker Martin Vichari from ABB Oschega in Lüdenscheid. He will present you something around ABB Secure at Home. And also together with us is Julia Castiglioni from the product management for these products, and she will help us in answering your questions. So I hand over to Martin now, just a moment.
Thank you, Thorsten, for the introduction, and hello and welcome also from my side. Yeah, the topic today is ABB Secure at Home. I think most of you will have at least heard something about the system, or maybe also saw some information or some slides or something at the trade or wherever. Still today, we want to give you one more time an overview about the system, about the devices we have, about the functionality, of course. And the focus for today will be on the planning side. So how do you plan a system? Which devices do you need? Where do you place which devices, and so on? So this is the main part for today. We have prepared some examples we want to show you. So I will start now with the presentation. One moment, please. Okay, so let's have a look at the agenda first of all. So as I said, we will start with a short introduction with some general information about the system itself. Then we will have some technical background information, first about the wireless technology and then about the sensors itself. And last, what is the most important part today is the planning of the system. So as I said, we have different use cases here and examples for you that you can see how you can set up a system. Okay, so first of all, what is Secure at Home? Secure at Home is an easy to use anti-intrusion system, and it completes more or less our residential portfolio, where we have with ABB Free at Home a home automation solution, and with ABB Welcome our door entry system. And now we also have an anti-intrusion system, which can be also integrated into this system. Secure at Home covers all important areas which must be protected in a house, so perimeter and indoor protection, outdoor protection, smoke and flood protection, and last, as I said, the smart home integration. Which applications we have? So outdoor protection, first of all, means of course, the use of sensors outside in the garden, for example, and detectors at the doors and windows. So the outdoor protection is always, we say, the first line of defense in a house. Also, then very important, of course, is the indoor protection. Here we have two different types, more or less. First of all, the volumetric sensors, which detect movement or presence inside the house, and then the perimeter detection sensors, which control any opening of the house, so any windows and doors where anyone could come in must be also protected, of course. Smoke and flood protection next. I think this is more or less clear for everyone. We have connected smoke detectors in our portfolio and a flood sensor, which detects the presence of water on the floor. I think this is clear, and the devices are not really new for you, but important still is that also these points are under control in a security system. Yeah, and last, the smart home integration, here with the clear advantage that we can use mixed scenes and actions with elements of our home automation system and our anti-intrusion system, so Free at Home and Secure at Home combined. We can have a remote access, and we can get push notifications to our mobile devices. When something is going on in our house, that you get a notification directly. So to summarize the main features of the system, of course, we have arming and disarming with the central unit, the remote control, or in combination with the Free at Home system, also with the Free at Home app. Intrusion detection with signaling, of course, combined scenes and actions and remote control, just like we just already mentioned. Okay, so here you can see an overview about all important points or key figures we have for secure at home. So first of all, of course, secure means we have a secure system here without any interferences. The reason we have an encrypted system, of course, here with a unique rolling code for arming and disarming controls. And what else? We are using the CSMA technology. That means that the transmitter is checking all the time if the band is occupied or not. And the system is only sending signals to the receiver when it's verified that the band is not occupied. This is very important that no signals get lost. Next point, the flexibility. So due to the wireless technology, we are flexible where we install the sensors, so we don't have to do any brickwork. Most of the sensors or all sensors are battery driven, so here we are very flexible how you plan a system and how you install the system. Of course, the commissioning part is very simple, and you can integrate it into our Free at Home system. So really to have a complete solution now with home automation and security. Okay, so next let's have a look at the wireless technology that we use here. For ABB, it was, of course, very important that the system fulfills two points in point of the technology that we use here. The first one was the system must be reliable. So we needed a reliable communication between the devices. And the second was security, so that the transmitted data must be safe. So without these two characteristics, no one would buy a security system, of course. So this was the most important points we had a look at when we planned this system. So how did we fulfill these two points? The first one, reliability. We are using the 868 megahertz frequency, which is regulated by European norms. This frequency is also less crowded than the 434 megahertz frequency. We have a good or an optimal communication through the CSMA transmission, so the carrier sends multiply access. So as I just explained, that means that the signals are only sent to the receiver when the band is not occupied. And with this technology, we make sure that no signals get lost. We have a distance up to 300 meters here, so which should be enough for the most installations and the most houses. If this might be not enough, you can use the additional repeaters we have in our portfolio to extend the signal range. And the second point, the security. How do we make sure that no one can control our system from outside or disarm the system from outside? So we protect our data with a digital 128-bit encryption. For the remote control, we are using a rolling code, so also no one can steal the code and come into my house without activation of the alarm, so no one can disarm it from outside. And of course, we have our sirens and remote communication through GSM available. So these are the points how we say, okay, this is also a secure solution. when we compare the wireless technology we use here in Secure at Home and the wireless technology you know from Free at Home, you will see that we have two different technologies. So in Secure at Home, we have, first of all, another protocol, and we have here a bi-directional communication. While in Free at Home, we are using the mesh network technology. So what does it mean? It means that in Free at Home, all devices are forwarding the signal more or less as a repeater, and they are building a mesh, so the mesh network. And in Secure at Home, we have a direct communication between the central unit and the sensors, the devices we have. Of course, if you use the repeater here, if you want to extend the range of the sensors, then it would forward the signal, but the devices and the sensors itself are only communicating with the central unit or with one repeater. Yeah, and also, of course, the aim of the systems are completely different. When you use Secure at Home, you're looking for security. When you use Free at Home, you're looking for home automation, for comfort, and for things like this. So two complete different technologies, but also two different systems. But together now, one solution for residential buildings. Okay, next, the devices we have in our portfolio. Yeah, so all in all, we have three different types of devices. First of all, of course, our system devices, our sensors for indoor and outdoor protection, and of course, also our safety devices. The focus today will be on the indoor and outdoor devices. So we will talk about the rest, of course, too. But the most important question of today is which sensor I have to buy for which use case, where do I have to install them, how is the detection range, and so on. So for all devices, we will also give you now some recommendations where and how you place them. And after that, we will also show you some examples of a complete solution. Okay, so first of all, our central unit. As you can see, the design is quite simple and easy to understand. We have a small 2.2 inch display and a keypad to arm and disarm the system, and of course also to navigate through the menus. And we have some additional LEDs here on the central unit, which display, for example, the actual status of the Free at Home connection. Two different versions are available, so one in white and one in black, and both colors or both devices are also available in one version with GSM and one without GSM. In the table below here, you can see how many devices you can use all in all. So up to 64 devices plus 4 sirens, 4 repeaters, and up to 16 remote controls. And what is also always very important are the zones. So you are able to create all in all 7 different zones for your system. And you have one dedicated zone for the safety devices. And of course, one also for the system devices, which are more or less every time used and always blocked for these devices. For all other sensors and areas in a house or in an apartment, you can create up to 7 zones completely free. Now where do we place the central unit? So usually the central unit is placed in the entrance of the building, or in the living room. These are two typical installation places. But of course, we know there might be customers who don't want it visible in the entrance area, or they want it a little bit more hidden in the bedroom, for example. This is, of course, also impossible. But most of the people, our recommendation is here to place it in the living room or in the entrance area. Okay, next our remote controls. We have one version available with neutral numbers, which can be programmed freely, and one more or less plug and play remote control. Here you have different icons available on the remote control, and four keys are also already pre-configured with the most common functions. So arm the entire system in home mode and in away mode. Disarm the entire system and launch the panic alarm, and one button here can be programmed individually. So these are the most common functions, which are more or less in every installation or from most of the users used. So we said, okay, we make one remote control, which is already pre-configured with this functions. Okay, next, our siren. I think I don't have to explain too much about it. We have it available also in three different colors. So depending also, of course, of the color of the house. And where to place it, yeah, in general, you have different options, which also depends, of course, on the customer wishes. So you can install it on the front side, visible, or on the back side, where maybe no one can see it. Here is important that you have to check maybe your local restrictions. We know from different countries that there are also local restrictions, which can be aesthetical restrictions or because of the noise. All in all, you are able to install four sirens in one system, so which should be in general enough for a house or for a also for a bigger house. Okay, let's start now with our different sensors. We will start with the sensors we have for indoor protection. So you already see we have different sensors available here, which can be used for indoor protection. And I want to start with the perimeter magnetic reach contact detector. So as you can see, it's a magnetic contact to detect the state of opening and doors of windows. And of course, you can trigger an alarm when a door or window is opened while the system is armed. What is important here for this device, you have an additional input in this device. And this input can be used to contact also additional sensors. This device here is battery driven, and we have some devices which can be connected to it. These devices are here, you can see them here. So these devices could be added to a magnetic contact, for example. What do we have? We have one additional magnetic contact and one rolling door magnetic contact. So this one used for garage doors, for example. Both of them are B-stable sensors. That means that as soon as they change the status, alarm would be triggered when the system is armed. And we also have the roller shutter sensor for blinds and the shock interior sensors also for windows or doors. These two sensors here are impulsive. That means now in this case that they will trigger an alarm as soon as one value of impulses is reached. So you can adjust the amount of impulses that are needed to trigger the alarm. You can say, for example, after 3 or 4 or 5 impulses, the alarm is triggered, and not after the first wind, for example, for the roller shutter and something is moving and it was the first impulse, that you don't have a false alarm. And as I said, for the B-stable devices, the alarm would be triggered directly. Now some use cases. So for DOS and Windows, first of all, we recommend the perimeter magnetic contact on the top. What is important for Windows? If you plan or your customer plan to keep the window partially open, then it might be useful to place one magnetic contact on the bottom of the window and one additional contact on the top. The reason is you can also define the topper magnetic contact not as B-stable, but as impulsive. And then you could define in the central unit in the commissioning part that the alarm should be triggered after two impulses, for example. This way you should you are able to let the window open partially. You arm the system, and the system will only trigger an alarm after the window is closed once, which is the first impulse, and then reopened, which is then the second impulse. And then the window or the alarm is triggered first. What else? Of course, you could also add here the shock interior sensor for additional protection. This could be also possible. But this is just for you, important to know if your customer plans to keep the windows maybe also open when he's leaving the house or arm the system. Okay, now two more use cases here for the rolling door magnetic read contact and for the roller shutter sensor. So as we said, first one here for garages, you place them on the bottom side and you get a signal as soon as the garage is opened. And for the roller shutter sensor, this one is usually installed somewhere in the box above the shutter. And here you can also would use maybe one magnetic contact and the roller shutter as add-on. Okay, so now we start with the movement sensors we have. So first of all, our dual passive IR perimeter motion detector. So the device you see here. This sensor is especially made for doors and windows. You can install it above a door or of course also above a window, and it creates more or less a tent for this door or window. You can see it here. So when someone would pass now this door, when the sensor is installed above the door, an alarm would be triggered. So suitable, of course, for windows and for doors. We have also one additional input for this movement detector. So this could be also combined with a magnetic contact, for example. Here also two examples with two pictures. How you could place the sensor. So typically it's installed between the window and the blinds. What you have to think about when you use this sensor, or you should be careful if your customer has domestic animals in the area, then you maybe shouldn't use this movement sensor, because it doesn't prevent a false alarm. So we have no animal protection here. When an animal would pass the area, the alarm would be triggered. So the sensor can't differentiate between a person and an animal. So this is of course also important for you to know when you want to use this sensor. So the next one is maybe the most important device for indoor protection. It's the PIR movement detector for indoor. So looks like this, also battery driven, of course, and we have an angle of 90 degrees here and up to 12 meters detection range. So a really good device for rooms inside the house, and you can cover really a wide area of one room. So very important for apartments and every rooms inside. Here we also have the pet immunity, which is also very important for a lot of customers. So you can see when you have different areas here for the movement detector, and two areas must be covered, or in two areas must be presence must be detected. If it's only one, maybe by a dog or a cat or any other animal, then no alarm will be triggered. So here we have this important feature for indoor, of course, when you have animals inside. What is also important when you install the sensor, please try to place it always into the direction of the room, so not into the direction of a window, or not into the outside direction, let's say. So always that the sensor looks into the room where no windows are placed. But we will also show you later some example how you should place it and how it's look like. Okay, so this were the inside sensors. So let's have a look now at the outside sensors. So you can see we also have different devices to protect different areas outside here. I will explain now also which sensors we have and where you can install them. Okay, the first one is the compact dual passive IR perimeter motion detector. Typical installation height is around 1 meter, and you have a detection range of 3 or 5 meters, so suitable for smaller areas outside. As you can already see here on the picture, you can adjust the direction of the sensor, so should it detect into the left or into the right side, or maybe also into the front. The sensor itself has two infrared detectors, and it will trigger the alarm also when you have detection in both sensors or in both areas. So again, if a car passes maybe the street, or an animal is running in the garden around, then no alarm will be triggered. Both sensors must detect presence. So here one example for the sensor. So here, for example, to protect the balcony. So as we said, this device usually used to control smaller walls up to 5 meters, or here in this example, for example, the balcony. Installation height, as said, around 1 meter, so would be good also to place it somewhere where no one can directly manipulate it or see it also. Okay, next one is the perimeter bidirectional dual PIR motion detector. So here the sensor detects into two sides, so you don't have to choose between left and right, it detects into both sides. And it has a distance up to 12 meters, so very good for larger areas or walls which you want to protect. We also have two sensors here per side, which must detect the presence to trigger the alarm, so same situation as before. Means also we have this pet immunity here. One of the sensors you can see here per side can be adjusted to change the distance you need for your use case. So you can adjust the lens to four different modes, and this sensor can also be used so for smaller areas. So you can choose between a direction 12 meters for one lens, or 8 meters, 5 meters, or also only 2 meters. So here you are quite flexible how much detection range you need. Yeah, one typical use case for this sensor is you can see here. So we have a quite long wall, maybe it's around 15 meters or something like this. So here we have a quite long wall, and we have more than several doors and windows. So here it makes sense to use this motion detector to protect the whole side of a house. So in general, you can say if you want to protect more windows or doors with one sensor, and you have a longer area or a wider area or a big wall, then this might be a good solution, because you can protect different areas and different points of the house with one sensor here. Okay, the next one is the outdoor dual passive IR motion detector. So similar detection range like the version for indoor, but here we have it IP55 protected, so you can use it outside. Yeah, you have here 6 different horizontal positions, and 5 different vertical adjustments are possible. So here you're also quite flexible in which direction the sensor should look like, and how far the direction, or how much range you need for the sensor for your use case. And again, we have the two areas here, the two IR sensors. So a false alarm by animals again can be protected or prevented, and the use cases for this one, I think, quite clear here. For our sample house, we used it to protect the front side of the house. Here, maybe please also don't forget, it has an installation height around 1 meter. So theoretically, it could be damaged or manipulated by other people. So it might be good to install it somewhere the people can't directly see it, or maybe not reach it so easy. Okay, with this sensors and movement detectors we have, would be also possible to protect a balcony, for example. So you have here one example. Because people often ask for this, because this is an important point also for customers, that the balcony is protected. So here, for a use case like this, it could be a good solution to use also two detectors, one for the area of the balcony and one to protect the entrance itself. Here you could also use, of course, also additional window contacts. So here you are also completely free to how you want to install them and use them. Okay, the last sensor we have for outdoor is the motion detector for high installation. That means you install it somewhere on the top of your house. And the detector is made to protect a bigger area, for example, a garden area, which you have often in bigger houses. So the installation height is between 250 and 3 meters. And it has also a range up to 12 meters in a 90-degree angle. So here you are also have a quite big angle and quite big range to cover a big part of your garden, for example. Yeah, and as I said here, an example with the to where it's used to protect the garden. So here, the back of the house. So when you want to make sure that no one comes next to the house, or you don't only want to use the door protection and the window protection, then it might be a good idea here to install it. No one can reach it because it has a high installation. And you can protect this way your garden, for example. Okay, last, our home safety devices. So nothing really new. We have a smoke detector, which works with optical detection. We have one a heat detector for heat detection for the kitchen, for example, where you have maybe smoke available and you don't want to trigger an alarm, then you use the heating detector. For both devices, you have to install the secure at home interface that the devices can communicate with the central unit. This is, of course, also important. Next, our flute detector for rooms where could be any problems with water. So this device also quite simple. It sends an alarm when the water on the floor is or the high water height exceeds 1 millimeter. So anywhere or everywhere where you install, washing machines or maybe also in general for the bathroom, this device could be also interesting for your customers. And the last device we have in our portfolio is the wireless repeater. So you would use this one if you have a bad signal somewhere in your house, or you have just a very, very big house and the range is not high enough, then you could use this repeater in your installation. Important is you can use at the maximum 4 repeaters, not more. So this is what you should think about when you plan the system. And on the commissioning part, but this you will also see when you install it and commission it, every sensor must really be connected to one repeater. So it doesn't connect automatically to the repeater that you say, you just place it and then it's okay. You really have to teach in the devices, the sensors to the repeater. Okay, so now the most important topic for today is the question, how to plan a system, as we said. And here we also have some advices and maybe first of all, some general questions you should think about when you have a project or you plan a system. So questions might be, which type of building do you have? Is it an apartment? Do you need other devices and maybe more indoor protection? Or do you have a big house? Then you also need outdoor protection. Then does the building have any particular topology? So we mean here, for example, balconies or garages, for example. So these are often points where people come into the house. Which security level is required? So here we differentiate between a basic and improved protection. So we will also show you the differences on the next slides. Then is the GSM supported? Do we have any restrictions, for example, for the outdoor siren? And also what might be interesting is also home automation, so our free at home system possible, wanted. Do my customer want it in combination? So these are first of all general questions you should think about. Then we made a short overview about all devices we have and where we can place them. So if you have an installation or an apartment or a house, then you can easily check for which perimeter, for example, which we have or which devices we have and which you can use. So for example, for doors and windows, for example, our motion detectors, which creates the tent and additional magnetic contacts. Same for balconies and for shutters, for example. Then the same also for indoor protection. So here in general, our movement detector and of course also for the outdoor area, garden, the house perimeter and the garage. And last, of course, also the safety solutions. So for which areas we have which devices or where should we install it in which rooms. Okay, but let's start now with some examples. So here in our first example, we have a small apartment. We have a quite big living room here together with a kitchen. one smaller bedroom, maybe for the child, and one bedroom for the parents, for example. And we have two bathrooms also available, and a small corridor here in the middle. So we will start now with the basic protection, and after that also with the improved protection, so that you will see the differences. So the first line we have for an apartment is the perimeter protection. So we have all in all four windows here available, and one door, of course. You could now go ahead and think about which devices would fit for these doors and windows. So here we choose one movement detector for the first window here in the living room. We used two magnetic contacts together with a roller shutter sensor for the two bedrooms, and two additional magnetic contacts for the door and for the window of the bathroom. So this way we should, or we can make sure that all perimeters are protected also with the basic protection. Yeah, next, the inside of the apartment. So we have here on basic level, we don't have too much equipment. First, of course, the central unit, which we place here next to the door, so in the entrance area. We've used two motion detectors, so one of it placed in the living room. So this covers also quite a wide area of the room. So here we also placed it on the left side. And what I mentioned before, not into the direction of the window, but away from the window to cover the entrance and the middle area of the room. And we have one motion detector for the entire corridor. In bathrooms and kitchens, usually motion detectors are not installed. Of course, you could also do it, but usually this is not so common. If you install a motion detector in a corridor, for example, like here, where the where also a bathroom is next to, then it should be you should have in your mind that it must be also turned off in night, for example, when someone is sleeping and he wants to go to the bathroom in the night, that not the alarm is triggered. Therefore, we have the different zones available. We will also show in a further example. Okay, so this is more or less now the basic protection. So you see also with few sensors or few amount of sensors, we can cover more or less the whole apartment here. If your customer wants more protection, then you could also offer him the improved protection. This could look like this now. So first of all, the perimeters again. Here we use more or less the same sensors like in our basic protection, of course. So we cover, or we want to protect all windows and doors, but we use here additional sensors for the windows, where we placed only one detector or one magnetic door contact before. So here, for example, additional magnetic contacts. Again, here also. Here you could, of course, decide, do you want to use the roller shutter sensor now, or the magnetic contacts. Here one example also with the zones I just mentioned. So here it could also make sense to think about different zones, especially when you use more than one or two movement detectors. So as I already said, we want to make sure that in the night, when you go from the bedroom into the bathroom, that no alarm is triggered. So here it could be a good idea to create two different zones for this apartment, zone A and zone B. When you leave your apartment and when you leave the whole area, then both zones are armed. In the night, only zone A is armed, for example. So for the night situation. The internal improved protection could look like this. So we now use five indoor movement detectors. One is added in the living room, so to cover not only the middle of the room, but this time both sides where people could enter the apartment. So now one motion detector for each bedroom also, and again one for the corridor. So here we just have a higher security level for each room. So improved protection could mean more or less that the whole area of an apartment is really covered and not only dedicated areas of a room or of an apartment. Improved protection could also mean that we work with safety devices now. So we installed two smoke detectors here. You could, of course, install also more, also, of course, depending on the regulations of each country. So we know that we have different regulations in different countries. So this is, of course, or this depends, of course, also on you and on your country. Next, we have also two water flute sensors here for the areas where water machines are placed, and one heat detector for the kitchen area here. So this could be a possible solution for a smaller apartment. Of course, this is not the only one right solution for an apartment like this. This is just a suggestion from our side. You could, of course, also use other sensors or install it in another way. So here you, of course, you are free to plan the system. But this might be at least one solution how the whole apartment is protected. Okay, we also have one example for a bigger house, so with a garden now, so that we also can talk about our outdoor devices. But here also the basic protection for the perimeter area first. More or less we use here the same sensors like for the apartment. Of course we have some more now, and we also have a garage here now. So here we could also use the rolling door magnetic reed contact. But in general, all doors and windows are protected with magnetic contacts and with the sensor which creates the tent. So this way, all entrances are protected. Of course, you could also add additional sensors for the inputs of the sensors, but this would be also then maybe already the improved protection. For the indoor basic protection, we choose here three motion detectors. Two sensors are placed in the living room and one on the top of the stairs, so to ensure that the top area is also protected. To cover the whole area, we would maybe need here five or also more motion sensors, but this would be again then the improved protection. How many sensors you use depends, of course, also again on your customer. So in the end, he will decide which level of protection he wants. This is important. Central unit is again placed here in the entrance area next to the front door. But as you can see, nothing really new in comparison to our apartment solution. What is new now is the outdoor area. So here we installed, first of all, one siren on the front side. We have one movement detector for the house entrance. And as you can see, one motion detector for the high installation to cover the area here above the garage. So, but this is of course only really basic protection. If you have a large garden like this, you could also protect much more here. So this is maybe then the improved version for the outdoor protection here. So here we have, of course, a lot of different options. So this is just an idea for you, not, as I said, the only right solution. So first of all, we have a second motion detector for high installation now, also for the backside of the garden. We have two bidirectional dual motion detectors to protect also the fence, which is here facing the street, and the bedroom side of the house, and a passive motion detector, which protects the kitchen here in on the front side. So this is, as I said, maybe a solution for a bigger garden when you want to control or protect all areas of the house. Okay, so this was more or less the most important points and hints for planning a system. One additional device when you plan a system, if you want to check the signal strength of the devices, if it's okay when you install the central unit, how you plan it. So before you install the sensors, we suggest this technique, quite simple here. So first of all, you place the central unit where you want to install it in this position. And then you go to all places or to all corners of the house, maybe where you want to install also a sensor, and then you try the remote control communication. So if the remote control doesn't communicate, then it might be a hint that you have to use a repeater. To make sure if it's good enough or not, then you could also use a real sensor then, because the sensors have a higher signal strength than the remote control. But if the remote control can communicate with the central unit, then you can be definitely sure that that the sensor is also possible. So this way you could check all installation places and all corners, and so you can see if the installation is okay, or if you have to maybe use repeaters or move the central unit. Okay, so now one very short preview about the commissioning part. So as you know, Secure at Home will be also be integrated into our Free at Home system, and that means that all the commissioning part will be also be possible done with Free at Home. But we will explain this in the following webinar, because also it must be available, of course, and it's also quite comprehensive and complex topic, so we will explain it later on in a separate webinar in detail. But of course, it's also possible to commission the system as a standalone system. This is, of course, also a possibility for you. Then you install it just with the central unit, and this is also possible. But also to this smart wizard we have here, you will get more information in a separated webinar. Okay, this was everything from my side for today, so I will hand back to Thorsten.
Thank you, Martin. We have seen there are a lot of products for different implementations available. I think you have to adapt it to your local situation, whatever you need, but you have a lot of options here with the sensors. And especially together with Free at Home, it's a very good extension in terms of application for a Free at Home system. And as mentioned by Martin, we will have then a further webinar about this commissioning part, so to get a real impression about the practical the commissioning part in principle, the practice together with the components. I have one final slide from my side I would like to show you. It has to do, of course, as always, with the next webinar. So what is planned for the next webinar in 3 weeks already, on the 13th of February? So we talk about different portions, let's say, of software tools around KNX. So I think there are some things to be where you should be informed about, because there are some changes in the ETS. We would like to talk about some apps, for example. We have this update app for firmware update, also a big topic nowadays, upcoming topic. Then we have this so-called DCA concept, device configuration apps, if we need for the first products in our range. We will give you an update about iBus tool, and as we have more and more Yeah, IP-connected KNX devices, where IP communication is important. Would like to give you here an information how to get access to these IP telegrams. So it's a basket of smaller things, but I think it will be a very interesting for those who work with KNX. So 13th of February, as always, two webinars. Thank you for your participation and see you next time. Bye bye and ciao.